In 1926, Universal Studios was on the rise. Riding high from the success of The Hunchback of Notre Dame and The Phantom of the Opera, the once struggling production house was rewarded for its ambition, and they decided the time was right to go international. So, the Jewish-owned film production company set up a branch in 1920s Germany. What could possibly go wrong? So it appeared that once again, Universal had a problem. They needed not one, but two icons. They needed Colin Clive and Boris Karloff. This is the story of how the novel that is often considered to be the birth of the science fiction genre was taken apart, rebuilt, and reanimated to become Universal's single most successful and influential horror movie. The story of the only creature that could possibly contend with the popularity of Dracula. The story of Frankenstein. Before we dive into the films, some background on the book that inspired them. In 1816, Mary Shelley, daughter of the renowned feminist icon Mary Wollstonecraft, found herself in the summer lodge of Lord Byron. Stuck indoors due to unseasonable weather, and inspired by a German book of ghost stories, Lord Byron proposed that his guests pass the time with a contest. Lord Byron, his physician John Polidori, Mary Shelley, and her husband Percy B. Shelley would each attempt to outdo the others in an effort to write the most compelling and dreadful horror story they could. That contest resulted in two major milestones in horror canon: John Polidori's The Vampire and Mary Shelley's Frankenstein, or The Modern Prometheus. The cultural influence of both stories is immeasurable, and while there is fierce debate over which would ultimately be the biggest pop culture phenomenon, Mary Shelley was declared the winner of that contest. Shelley incorporated many aspects of her life into the story. Her mother died of medical complications caused by Mary's birth, and Mary herself would undergo multiple miscarriages and infant fatalities. Add to it the fact that her husband's ex-wife had committed suicide, and Mary had a very familiar relationship with death, albeit a strange one. There's a popular anecdote that Mary lost her virginity on her mother's grave, both as a way to stick it to death itself and as a refusal of traditional social marriage and gender norms, which was a move her mother absolutely would have been ecstatic about. While there's no concrete evidence confirming that this happened, we can say with some confidence that there was at least one occasion where Mary was at that cemetery with her future husband, and that something definitely went down. So, make of that what you will. Aside from just her personal life, Mary also drew a lot of inspiration from the scientific world around her. At around the time of her writing, she would have very likely been aware of natural philosophers Giovanni Aldini and Johann Conrad Dippel, who had both been making very public attempts at reanimating dead tissue and extending human life through electrical and chemical means. Obviously, neither were successful. The subtitle of her book was also likely to be at least partially inspired by Benjamin Franklin, whose contemporary experiments with electricity earned him the nickname the Prometheus of Modern Times. It's also just one of many literary parallels in the book, alongside, most prominently, Paradise Lost and The Rime of the Ancient Mariner. Prometheus was the Greek Titan who created humanity, and who was punished for bestowing forbidden knowledge upon mankind after stealing fire from Zeus. It's not exactly a one-to-one parallel, but the similarities should be pretty clear in a moment. In case you slept through this portion of your high school lit class, here's a summary of the book's plot. The book begins with Captain Robert Walton, who is writing letters to his sister about his scientific voyage, a sailing expedition to the North Pole where he plans to travel farther north than anyone has ever gone before. Along the way, he and his team spot a dog sled being driven by a gigantic figure, and shortly thereafter find a man who is unconscious and freezing to death in the ice. The crew rescues and provides medical attention to the man, who then introduces himself as Victor Frankenstein. Victor sees in Walton an obsession for knowledge that is dangerously similar to his own, and he warns Walton to back down from his quest, telling his own story as a cautionary tale. He details an obsession with death from a young age, and the heavy impact that the death of his mother, Mary Wollstone, Madam Frankenstein, had on him as a youth. He went off to university in Ingolstadt and quickly outpaced his contemporaries, dropping out from his studies to pursue his own theories and experimentations on reanimation. He then constructs a big lad, since the intricacies of constructing the delicate veins and arteries of a human body become far easier when everything is upscaled and the parts are all bigger. Through unexplained methods, he bestows life upon this creation, and, despite having made the creature to be conventionally attractive, everything about it falls squarely into the uncanny valley. The combination of nearly translucent skin, unnatural movement and mannerisms, and disturbing eyes makes it a truly horrific sight to behold, and Victor immediately has a nervous breakdown and abandons his creation. He is then taken in by his childhood friend, Henry Clerval, and after several months of recovery, Victor receives word from his family that his younger brother, William, was killed, and that the family maid, Justine Moritz, was convicted of the crime. Victor comes home to investigate and immediately realizes that his creature is responsible for it. But he is too afraid of scrutiny and accusations of madness to step up and defend Justine. He tries and fails to convince himself that no one would believe him anyway, and, as Justine hangs, his guilt drives him to another panic attack that takes him up the nearby mountains, where he encounters his creature. To his surprise, the creature is far more physically and mentally advanced than he ever could have predicted, and it pleads for Victor's help, recounting its own story to explain its circumstances. After the creature was abandoned, it adapted to its environment at an astonishing rate, educating itself through stolen books and from observation of society from a distance, in particular, the family of a blind hermit. The creature is repeatedly shown cruelty at the hands of humanity in reaction to its hideous appearance, and, in kind, it begins to retaliate, killing first out of self-defense, then out of vengeance, eventually burning down the house of the blind hermit's family and making its way to Frankenstein's village in search of its creator. In order to draw out Victor, it murders William and frames Justine for the crime, and now that it has lured in Victor as a captive audience, it coerces him into creating a second creature to give it companionship. Out of a combination of fear, hubris, and curiosity, Victor agrees and begins work on constructing a female creature. In the process, however, Victor has yet another panic attack, becoming fearful of the equally daunting possibilities of either the female creature rejecting his original creation and now having to deal with two angst-ridden, emotionally unstable superhumans, or the two creatures procreating and spawning an entirely new species of monstrosities. In the midst of this fit, he tears apart the incomplete female creature, to the dismay of his original creature, who swears revenge against him and promises to
be there on his wedding day.
Victor rushes home and insists that he and his childhood sweetheart, Elizabeth, get married immediately before the creature can interfere. Mistakenly believing that the creature is after him, Victor leaves Elizabeth alone after the service so he can patrol the vicinity to defend himself and hunt down his creature. However, the creature had actually been hiding in Elizabeth's bridal suite the entire time, and it emerges and kills Elizabeth, taking Victor's bride away the way Victor took away its bride. An enraged Victor then swears revenge on his creature and pursues it with intent to kill all the way up to the Arctic wastes, where he collapses from exhaustion before being rescued by Captain Walton. After Victor's story, Walton and his crew become stuck in the ice, and Victor, still obsessed in his pursuit of the creature, rallies the crew and demands they continue forward regardless. They refuse. Victor quickly dies of exhaustion, and Walton finds the creature having hidden on board his ship. The creature mourns the loss of its creator and insists that, in spite of everything, Victor's death only deepens its sorrow. It then vows to kill itself, fleeing from the ship into the ice, never to be seen again. Mary Shelley initially published the book anonymously, and it had a mostly positive reception, though that reception became a bit more mixed once it was revealed that it was written by a woman.
No, God! No, God, please, no! 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 No!
Over time, however, it would go on to gain such widespread acclaim and become such a cultural cornerstone that it would give birth to several new subgenres of science fiction, and arguably, to science fiction itself. Though there is disagreement as to whether it can truly be considered the first science fiction story, it is certainly one of the stories most influential in popularizing the genre. And, unlike its predecessors, it chose to forego the presence of more fantastical elements in favor of exploring the limits of humanity through purely scientific means. The character of Victor Frankenstein has his roots in Dr. Faustus and in the Greek myth of Prometheus, both of whom were punished for the pursuit of forbidden knowledge, though Victor Frankenstein's use of technology rather than magic makes him the first true mad scientist, predating Dr. Henry Jekyll by 70 years. His creature is similarly influential, though ideas of artificial life through automatons and golems predate Frankenstein. The creature is considered one of the foremost examples of the artificial human. Frankenstein is also one of the primary stories that popularized the angsty, Byronic hero, since both the creature and Victor Frankenstein are, in many ways, caricatures of Mary's personal friend, Lord Byron. The story also serves as a rare early example of an anti-hero versus anti-villain story. Victor, as a protagonist, is horrendously short-sighted and self-centered to a fault, and the creature, as an antagonist, although becoming a calculating and malicious force over the course of the story, is presented primarily as a victim of society and is in a fairly sympathetic light for a majority of the book. The novel's influence and radical new ideas made it an obvious choice for adaptation, but the story's highly philosophical foundation made it difficult to translate to a visual medium. There were a few stage plays that attempted to do just this, which achieved moderate success, and in the advent of film, it was a popular topic of adaptation. 1910's Frankenstein, 1915's Life Without Soul, and 1920's The Monster of Frankenstein all predate the famous Universal film, but all of them have since been lost to time. And none of them were anywhere near as influential as the oldest surviving film adaptation, 1931's Frankenstein. Riding on the back of the successes that Universal had in the 1920s with The Hunchback of Notre Dame and The Phantom of the Opera, Carl Laemmle gifted ownership of the studio to his son, Julius Laemmle, on his 21st birthday in 1926. Julius, who was referred to by the studios almost exclusively as Carl Jr., was far less frugal than his father and had much higher ambitions. He convinced the company to modernize itself, converting their new productions into talkies, and finally doing what his father would not and purchasing the studio's own chain of movie theaters. Carl Jr. also launched the company into a series of high-budget productions whose timing could not possibly have been worse. Struck financially by the back-to-back blows of the American stock market collapse and Great Depression that followed, and the Nazi occupation of Germany, Universal was left in a dire monetary position. So, Carl Jr. turned back to the horror films that had put them on the map in the first place, shifting the studio's focus and attention onto the two standout works of Lord Byron's competition. He purchased the rights to both Frankenstein and Dracula, the most famous story that Polidori's The Vampire had inspired. Dracula has its own very extensive history and legacy that will be the topic of discussion for another video another day, but Needless to say, the success of that film and its $400,000 box office profit made Frankenstein an obvious next choice. Universal's acquisition of the Frankenstein property not only gained them the rights to the Mary Shelley novel, but also to the unfinished and ultimately unproduced stage adaptation of the story by Peggy Webling, which director Robert Florey then went on to base his script on. Having seen the success of Dracula, Florey was dead set on casting Bela Lugosi as his leading man. And Lugosi was absolutely thrilled by the prospect of playing Victor Frankenstein. The problem was that neither Florey nor the studio wanted him to play Victor Frankenstein, wanting him instead to play the monster, which Lugosi took as a personal offense. Lugosi refused to participate in Florey's version of the film, which depicted the monster as a ruthless killing machine, and without Lugosi at the helm, Florey refused to carry on with the production, and also left. This was widely regarded as one of the worst career decisions that either of them ever made, and it allowed the film's new director, James Whale, to step up into the spotlight. Whale completely rewrote and overhauled Florey's script, changing the monster into a far more sympathetic and innocent figure, which was a major risk at the time in the more morally simple film landscape. He then brought on Colin Clive, who he had previously worked with, into the role of Frankenstein. He initially offered the role of the monster to John Carradine, who, like Lugosi, turned the part down, feeling that the role was beneath him. And it was then that Whale stumbled into the perfect casting. On a trip to the Universal Commissary, Whale bumped into a tall, gaunt-looking British actor who was practicing for a bit role he was playing elsewhere. Whale instantly took a liking to this man and slipped him an invitation to screen test as the monster. The man was thrilled by this opportunity and leapt at the chance for his first ever starring role. The man rushed promptly to the screen test and scribbled on the sign-in sheet the name Boris Karloff, and his fate was sealed. The film that Karloff, Clive, and Whale would go on to create was significantly different from the source material, and would really only share the name and core concept in common. The book's story was divided up across both Frankenstein and its sequel, Bride of Frankenstein, so here's a rundown of both of their plots. The film begins by reminding you that it is the 1930s, by giving credit for the novel that inspired the film to Mary Shelley's husband, instead of her. Then, after a brief warning that this spooky movie will, in fact, be spooky, we open on Baron Henry Frankenstein and his hunchbacked assistant, Fritz, stealing freshly hanged corpses from the nearby graveyard. They take the parts back to Henry's laboratory, where he reveals that he is constructing a human from scratch, and all he needs now is a brain. Henry sends Fritz to his university, where a biology professor once again reminds us that it was the 1930s, by demonstrating the physiological differences between the good brain of a normal, moral, and just man and the malformed and evil brain of a commonplace criminal. After the lecture, Fritz attempts to steal the normal brain, but accidentally damages it and takes the criminal brain instead. Then, Henry's fiancée Elizabeth, his friend Victor, and his assistant Waldman discover that he's attempting to create life and rush to his lab to stop him from going too far. They arrive as Henry begins his experiment and watch as Henry raises the body into the thunderstorm overhead. The experiment is a success, resulting in one of the most famous lines of dialogue in film history.
It's alive!
The monster comes to life, and in spite of its unsettling appearance, it seems to be completely innocent and childlike. Until, that is, Fritz comes too close to the monster with a lit torch. The monster flails around in a panic, which is interpreted by the others present as a spontaneous and violent attack. They detain the monster in a holding cell and chain it to the wall so it can't cause any further damage. Fritz then sneaks into the cell when the others are away and torments the monster, attacking it and delighting in its fear of fire. The monster then breaks out of its chains and kills Fritz in self-defense, and Henry and Waldman arrive to sedate it, the former insisting that it is too dangerous and must be destroyed. Henry then has a sudden nervous breakdown, and Waldman insists that Henry must rest and prepare for his wedding with Elizabeth while Waldman take care of the monster. The monster awakens before Waldman can kill it, and it fights back, strangling Waldman and escaping the laboratory. The escaped monster wanders the countryside, encountering a little girl playing by the lake. The curious monster is delighted by the little girl and joins her in a game of throwing flower petals on the lake. It is overjoyed when the flower petals float, and once it runs out of flowers to throw, it grabs the little girl and throws her in the water, not understanding that she won't float and can't swim. The girl drowns, and the monster slowly begins to realize what it has just done, running away in a guilt-stricken panic. Meanwhile, Henry and Elizabeth are interrupted from their wedding preparations by Victor, who reveals that Waldman has been killed and the monster is on the loose. At the same time, a mob begins to form as the little girl's father finds her body and rallies the town to hunt and kill the monster. Henry gets to the monster first, but is knocked unconscious and carried up to an old windmill. The mob follows closely behind as the monster climbs to the top of the building and throws Henry off the roof. Henry manages to survive the fall and is dragged away by the mob, who then set the windmill on fire with the monster trapped inside. The film then abruptly ends with an epilogue of Henry and Elizabeth's wedding. So, you probably noticed that a few of the names were a little off. So, before I move on to Bride of Frankenstein, here's what happened there. Whale and the Universal execs were a little uneasy about the name Victor Frankenstein, since it was a name they felt was harsh and unsympathetic. It was also a very German-sounding name, and, well, so, wanting to change Victor's name to something they felt audiences could better connect to and sympathize with, they swapped the first names of Victor Frankenstein and Henry Clerval, giving us Henry Frankenstein and Victor Clerval. But since Clerval was a well-liked character in the book and was mostly referred to by last name, they couldn't leave it there as they didn't want the name change to cause confusion. So they obscured it still further by swapping Clerval's last name with that of the falsely executed maid, Justine Moritz, giving us Victor Moritz and Justine Clerval. Justine was dropped from the film, so we were left only with Henry Frankenstein and Victor Moritz. The boat captain, Robert Waldman, was also repurposed into the story as Henry's associate and lab assistant. Though his name was left unchanged, so as to avoid potential confusion. Has your confusion been sufficiently avoided? Good, because now we're moving on to Bride of Frankenstein. In 1935, this follow-up film to Frankenstein actually did give proper credit to Mary Shelley. The film opens in the summer estate of Lord Byron, where he, Mary Shelley, and Percy Shelley are all discussing her story, and Byron gives a hasty recap of the events of the previous film. He comments that it's a shame the story ends so abruptly, and Shelley assures him that the last film's ending is not actually the end of the story. The film then resumes immediately after the events of the first Frankenstein movie, showing that the monster survived the fire and escaped from the wreckage of the windmill. Meanwhile, Henry, still recovering from the events of the previous movie, swears off his experiments. As he does, he is interrupted by a visit from his former university professor, Dr. Septimus Pretorius, who wishes to discuss Frankenstein's monster. Pretorius explains that he has been disbarred and stripped of his university position for performing experiments similar to that of Henry's. His big breakthrough was creating creatures from scratch, growing miniature humans like bacteria cultures. However, he has been unable to make anything that could survive long-term that was larger than a few inches, and certainly nothing comparable to Henry's monster. Pretorius proposes that he and Henry work together to create another new creature, Pretorius growing the brain from scratch, and Frankenstein assembling and reanimating the body. Henry is not convinced, and Pretorius leaves him to think over his proposal. In the meantime, the monster is once again roaming the countryside, and encounters a drowning woman. The monster, remembering the little girl from the first film, rescues her, and is thanked by screams of terror and gunshots from nearby hunters who assume that it must be attacking her. The monster then encounters a blind hermit, who takes it into his cottage and gives a prayer of thanks for being sent a friend. The hermit treats the monster with patience, respect, and kindness for the first time in its life. The monster breaks down in tears of joy and relief, and the hermit teaches it rudimentary language and decorum. The movie then takes another moment to remind us that it is the 1930s. By teaching the monster how absolutely rad and amazing smoking is. The hunters that attacked the monster before stumble across the cottage and attack. The monster defends its new friend, and in the process, the cottage catches fire and burns down, the monster running away and hiding in a nearby crypt, which Dr. Pretorius just so happens to be visiting. Pretorius notices the monster and lures it in with food and drink, and then promises that he will make the monster a friend and mate. Pretorius then confronts Henry, who refuses to go along with the experiment, and in response, Pretorius summons the monster. The monster kidnaps Elizabeth, and Pretorius promises that she will be returned to Henry unharmed if he cooperates. Henry reluctantly returns to his old laboratory and begins the process anew, quickly becoming caught up in the excitement of the process once again. After bringing the bride to life, the monster asks for it to be its friend, and the bride, terrified by the monster's appearance, rejects it outright. The monster is heartbroken that not even one of its own kind will accept it, and it lashes out at Pretorius in response. The monster releases Henry and Elizabeth, condemning itself, Pretorius, and the bride, as it destroys the lab equipment, bringing the building down on top of them. The initial Frankenstein film was unlike anything the general public had ever seen before, and despite being heavily censored in much of the US and banned outright in countries like China, where supernatural depictions of the dead are a cultural taboo, it was a smash success. Critically beloved in its time, and even more so with cultural reevaluation, it's often been regarded as one of the most important films ever made, one of the greatest films of 1931, and one of the greatest films of American cinema in general, being one of very few movies to have a 100% rating on Rotten Tomatoes. Commercially, the film was a powerhouse. With a budget of roughly $260,000, it would go on to earn a total box office profit of $12 million. As for The Bride of Frankenstein, while it is also widely praised by critics and in many circles considered to be a superior film to the first, though there is plenty of debate between the two, it did not fare nearly as well commercially. With a budget of roughly $400,000, it earned approximately $2 million at the box office, which, granted, is still no small thing, and is a major profit and marked success. These two films would go on to codify nearly everything we associate with evil science to this day, between the thunderstorms, the angry mobs, the use of Tesla coils, Bunsens, beakers, and electrical equipment. Every mad scientist character that has ever existed owes at least a small part of their inspiration to Victor/Henry Frankenstein and Dr. Pretorius. Pretorius himself is also a pretty interesting case, since he more or less is what happens when you split the creature from the book into two separate characters. Pretorius is a bit of a mixed bag in terms of what he contributes to the story. He renders Henry Frankenstein less unique, now that there's just some other guy who can also do the super impressive science thing. But structurally, his existence allows the film to accelerate the story's timeline so it can take place over the course of a few days rather than a few years. And he also gives someone for both Henry and the monster to interact with.
Most vitally, he is also the primary reason the monster is even allowed to be as sympathetic as it is in the first place. Since Bride of Frankenstein was released at the beginning of the Hays Code, Hollywood films were beginning to be heavily policed for their moral content. And one of the primary restrictions had to do with the strict dichotomy of good versus evil. By including Pretorius in the film, it gives the movie an obvious villain who isn't the monster, which allows it the freedom to exist in more of a morally gray area. The scenes between the monster and the hermit, and the monster and the bride, are some of the best and most emotionally compelling performances of Karloff's career, and they would not be possible if not for this silly, campy, cartoonishly evil scientist. Beyond Pretorius, the films had an absolutely enormous cultural footprint. Their setting, which has been endlessly evoked in other projects, was, by design, chock full of anachronisms. Set in the 1800s, but with a mix of modern 20th century electrical appliances and furnishings, combined with period architecture, set pieces, and props, Whale set out to make the feature feel timeless. The behind-the-scenes filmmaking techniques also established the monster as having green skin. Though they had intended for the monster's skin to be ghoulishly discolored, pale, and gray, this was difficult to pull off with monochrome film cameras. After a large amount of experimentation, they found that light green was the color that showed up best on camera, in order to make Karloff look much more pale and lifeless than those around him. The color of Karloff's makeup helped make the monster, and by extension, zombies in general, become known for having green skin. Now, you may have noticed that I've been avoiding talking about one of the biggest and most important aspects of the Mad Scientist, and that's because I felt it deserved special attention. This is a character who is never seen without a Frankenstein or a Pretorius or other similar mad doctor, and whose relationship to their deranged employer is symbiotic. I am, of course, talking about the Igor.
No, it's pronounced Igor.
While there is no trace of any such character in the original Mary Shelley novel, the existence of a crazed lab assistant actually does begin in her lifetime. The play Presumption, or The Fate of Frankenstein, was the first official stage adaptation of the story, which Shelley herself attended and publicly praised. This play retold the story of the book with some significant adjustments, including the addition of a bumbling servant named Fritz. Fritz was an assistant paid by Henry Clerval to keep an eye on Victor, and he served as a person who Victor could explain the science to, and to whom he could voice his internal struggles aloud. Fritz proved to be so narratively useful that nearly every adaptation afterwards began to utilize variations of him, including the 1931 Universal film. It is this version of Fritz that cemented the lab assistant character as a deranged hunchback, since actor Dwight Frye brought a similar manic energy to the character as he did with Renfield in Dracula earlier that same year. The Igor character as we know them today is an amalgamation of both Fritz and Renfield, with his name being taken from the central villain of the third and fourth Frankenstein films. Here, Igor, played by Bela Lugosi, is a grave robber who was captured by the village and falsely hanged due to his suspected involvement with the creation of the Frankenstein monster. The hanging was botched, and he survived, permanently disabled with a broken neck and dislocated shoulders. Igor lived in seclusion until he stumbled across the body of the monster in the wreckage of the old Frankenstein lab, comatose, but not dead. He then convinces Henry Frankenstein's son, Dr. Wolf von Frankenstein, the only Frankenstein to have actually earned the title of doctor, to revive it. Over the course of the two movies, Igor takes control of the monster and manipulates it into killing the jurors who sentenced him to hang, and then tricks the Frankensteins into transplanting his brain into the monster's body.
I am not Dr. Kettering. I am Igor.
What have I done?
In an ironic twist of fate, Bela Lugosi would then go on to play the Frankenstein monster, being piloted by Igor's brain, in the follow-up film, Frankenstein Meets the Wolfman. While Bela Lugosi's Igor has little in common with the characters that would later steal his name, his performance in the multiple movies would help ensure that the name stuck. And ever since, mad scientists following in Frankenstein's footsteps would seldom be seen without their Igor. Mary Shelley's story about the arrogant college dropout who attempted to play God and was not prepared to face the consequences of succeeding changed everything. The cultural footprints of both the book and the film run deep, and the myriad of adaptations from Universal to Hammer Studios to Mel Brooks to Nick Deere showcase just how impactful this story was. In the case of Universal, it allowed the studio to continue to survive the hardships of the 1930s and made an overnight sensation out of Boris Karloff, cementing his A-list status as a horror icon. Wanting to capitalize on this success and continue riding this momentum, Carl Jr. would commission another vehicle for Karloff to star in. But this time, he wanted an original story, one which would create an entirely new iconic kind of monster, never before seen in the world of horror. I'm Danger Dan Jers, and be sure to join me next time as we examine the mystical spark of life that was The Mummy, and the cursed legacy of the films that would follow in its shambling footsteps. Thanks for watching.
If you're blue and you don't know where to go to, why don't you go where fashion sits?